Anyway, so this is session 26, right? And yep. Oh, by the way, I want you guys to order a book.
Here it is here. So this is Darren Hardy, right?
Benjamin.
No, not Darren Hardy, Benjamin Hardy. He has this book, Be Your Future Self Now, The Science of Intentional Transformation. Well, that's what we're doing. We're intentionally transforming ourselves, right?
Yeah.
And so it says here, this isn't a book about becoming, it's about being. Noted psychologist Dr. Benjamin Hardy shows how to imagine the person you want to be and then be that person now. When you do this, your imagined future directs your behavior rather than the past.
Right. So that idea of being directed by your future self rather than your past is a big shift. And, of course, we tend to be directed by our past because all of our beliefs, our attitudes, our prejudices, our fears, anytime that we have any, you know, thought that says, you know, can I do this or is this going to be too difficult or, you know, whatever. I mean, they're all coming from the past self. So to turn that around and start coming from your future self is huge. And the fact that it's a science, well, of course, it is a science now, ever since 1995 when, as I mentioned, you know, they using the functional MRI, they discovered two things, which to me are just earth-shattering and completely change everything. I mean, they're as important as when Galileo built a telescope and was able to see the moons of Jupiter and say, ah, the earth is not the center, right? It's that big. And it's going to change everything about psychology, philosophy, you know, metaphysics of mind and personal growth and habit formation. And, you know, it's going to change everything. It's changing everything already. And we've talked, you know, a fair bit about that from my perspective. But he's a guy that's, I'm not sure how old he is. He might be 40, which so it probably means he was born about 1980. Which is around the time that I had my, you know, epiphany about thinking is a connection, right? And your mind is a time machine. And so he's grown up not only with sort of a new take on personal growth, you know, and self-improvement and that kind of thing, but he's got a PhD in psychology, so he's been studying what they now call positive psychology, which is a new way of looking at psychology. It's only been around, I think, since about the 80s. But, you know, psychology always used to use what they call the medical model, right? Because, of course, they're all doctors, you know, and psychiatrists, you know, they were all MDs, right? And so starting back with Freud, they have always had this medical model, which is if you're healthy, don't do anything. If you're sick, then we'll do something. So that's what happens, right? You know, we get sick, we go to the doctor. But starting, I think, in around 1980, maybe, psychiatrists and psychologists, mostly psychologists, they started looking at, well, what is it that healthy people are doing, you know? Before a person gets, you know, sick and needs drugs or intervention or counseling or, you know, behavioral therapy, something like that, what is it that the people are doing that are actually happy and successful and, you know, goal-oriented and motivated and that sort of thing? So that was a radical departure from the past. But now it's like 30, 40 years later, right? And so people like, you know, Benjamin Hardy, he's grown up in that milieu, and he's really got his finger on the pulse of all the latest information about, you know, the mind and consciousness and how it works. And so they're throwing out the old model, which basically says you are the way you are because of your past. Now they're saying you are what you are or who you are because of your future, right? And which, of course, if you think about it, it's like obvious, right? I mean, anybody who is successful because they look to the future and they say, I want that, you know? So that's the future self, right? I mean, that goes for any person who has a goal, anybody who is ambitious, you know? And, of course, the problem with other people who are unhealthy is they're anchored in the past. You know, they say things like, well, that's the way I am. Well, that's not the way you are.
Right.
Were you born that way? You know, no, you weren't. You learned to be that way. And you can unlearn it, right? So this idea of, you know, the future self is really powerful. So his book was just published. And you can get a copy of it on Kindle for 99 cents. And today's the last day. So... But anyway, so I'm going to recommend that you guys go to Amazon and look at, you know, Be Your Future Self Now and get yourself a copy of that Kindle book, because I think it's going to be, you know, life-changing, right?
I had a lady on my podcast a couple years ago where she actually takes her clients and she takes them on a photo shoot and sets them up in the scene of what they want their life to look like. They dress them the way that they want to be dressing. They take them to where they want to be, and they do a photo shoot. And she said 12 months max, and these people are living that life.
Yeah.
Because exactly what you're talking about, like, your unconscious does not know the difference. And as soon as you become that in your mind, you become that in reality.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's, I mean, it's similar to the idea of... a vision board, right? So so I wanted to talk about your dream. Because you had this dream, right? You mentioned
right.
You mentioned it last week. And so you mentioned it right at the end of the meeting that we had last week. So I didn't want to get into it then because we were already about an hour and a half in. So...
Great.
So, but I want to talk about this week because I think it's really important to pay attention. One of the things I talked about in a previous session was this idea of opening your third eye. You remember that one?
Yes, I do.
This is a term that we get from the world of ESP and psychic phenomena and stuff like that, right? And so the whole idea of being able to see your future, of course, people either think it's impossible, or if you mention the word psychic or ESP, people think you're either out of your mind or you're talking about stuff that's like witches and devil worshippers and things talk about, right? There's a real stigma around that. And so what I've learned in my life is basically that this is just natural. This idea of ESP, it's using your third eye. It's using your inner senses, right? So when you're visualizing your future goals, you are using your psychic ability, right? So this thing here says clairvoyance may be one result of a developed third eye, but this energy center is responsible for so much more than predicting future phenomena. When we open the third eye, we become aware of the big picture. This ability to see everything shifts our perspective, so we can see our own blind spots, understand ourselves in the context of the collective, meaning everything, right? But in order to use the third eye to see through time and space, we first have to use it to see ourselves, right? So this kind of mystical language is what you hear about in the sort of New Age, ESP, astrology kind of world, which I was in for a while. I spent several years in that world being, you know, I call myself a clairvoyant psychic, right? And so I traveled around and I did these workshops and helping people develop ESP. But what I was just, you know, what I was talking about was this, right?
Right.
And so that dream that you had is something like the dream I had, where you were kind of floating, you said, you know, you were in your body, out of your body, looking down at your body and seeing the past and the present and the future, right?
Right.
Something like that. And here's a slide from a book, which is a great book, by the way. This guy's a quantum physicist. He calls himself Dr. Quantum. His name is Fred Allen Wolf. And he's written about 20 books on quantum physics and consciousness. And so this is an illustration from one of his books. It says, for each of us, an indefinite number of universes exists simultaneously, right?
Right.
So these are like the timelines that we've talked about in the past. It says here, each universe may be a slight variation of the next one, or may be entirely unrelated. Each universe has its own time sequence. Well, to me, what this is how our imagination works. This is what we're doing in our mind when we are using our imagination, right?
Right.
So does this relate to that dream you had?
Yeah, it does. But I've been kind of doing this where I've been moving forward and back, but also sideways.
Yes, sideways in time, my favorite topic.
So, well, in space, too. So sideways in time and space.
Yep.
You know, start with those two elements. Usually there could be different options, left and right, which is kind of that vector that you were talking the railroad train. But now when you go 3D with it,
yep,
you start to have you know, kind of like I was envisioning these three-level, and seeing them Star Trek sometimes, we have the three-level chessboard.
Right.
Which is very similar to that. But you're moving forward, kind of onto different successive chessboards, but left and right as well. And that can either be time, or it can be space, if that makes sense.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. Well, I have a similar concept, you know. So the way I finally learned to look at it was, you know, these different timelines, they're like different streets, or as I said in my book, like different tracks of a train, right? Like if I go downtown, I live on the harbor, right? So the harbor kind of curls around behind me here. And so there's two bridges I can go over to get downtown from where I am. And so those are parallel realities, right? They're parallel, like, timelines. If I go down over one bridge, I see one thing. I have one experience, you know. And if I go over the other bridge, well, I have another experience. I see different things. I experience different things. You know, I see different people, right? So to me, that's like the parallel realities, you know.
Right.
And so, but the way I look, so that's like moving sideways in time, right? Because when I am, when I'm on the one bridge, I can look over and I can see the other bridge.
Right.
You know, I can imagine, oh, I could be over there, but I'm not over there. I'm over here, right?
Right.
And so another thing that I thought was, you know, we think of time and space as three-dimensional, right?
Right.
But Einstein says it's actually four dimensions. And other scientists now, and all this comes from mathematics, right? I mean, this is, you know, they look at the mathematics and they interpret it, right? The same as they say, well, wait a second, here's a 7. Well, a 7 could be 4 plus 3. So if I think of it as 4 plus 3, what does that mean? You know, so this is what they do, right? So they come up with all of these possible variations. And if you watch YouTube, you know, there's all kinds of videos on there from scientists talking about, you know, multiple universes, parallel realities, you know, and they say things like, you know, there's some, You know, there's a universe somewhere where you have an exact clone who wears the same clothes as you, has the same thoughts as you. Well, I think they're out of their minds, you know. That's not what it is. What it is the imagination, right? And there are a lot of scientists around now, quantum physicists, and one of them is Michio Kaku, who you've probably seen.
Yep.
And another one is Fred Allen Wolf, you know, who say that what we're describing with all of our mathematics, we're not describing the universe. We're describing our mind. We're not talking about the universe. We're talking about the way we imagine the universe, right?
Right.
So this idea of multidimensional consciousness, getting back to Einstein, you know, here I am at the moment. I'm sitting in this place. I have, you know, like a two-dimensional map. I could give you the coordinates of my house. And the other dimension is time. So if you had the, you know, if you had the dimensions of my house and you came here now in this time, you would see me here on the, you know, on looking at you guys on the computer, right? But if you came yesterday, maybe I wouldn't be here, right? I might have been out yesterday, right? So there's the fourth dimension. But what they're talking about, again, stemming from this mathematics, right? They're saying there may be as many as 12 dimensions. So what are they? How do they work, right? Well, the way I think they work is very simple, right? They are emotions. That's a simple way to look at it, right? So in other words, I could be here in this place at this time right now, and I could be depressed. Or I could be sitting here now in the same location, same time, happy. So to me, that's how those ultimate other dimensions work, you know. And this is one of the most exciting things that I have experienced, is this idea of being able to change what dimension you're in, right? Because using the past successes list and all those kind of tools that we've talked about so far, one of the effects of them is changes your emotions, changes the neurochemicals in your brain, right? When you feel down, everything is dark, right? All you have is problems. But when you feel up, you know, you have opportunities, right? It's a different way of looking at it. It's a different way of seeing things. Now, one of the things that we talked about in the past, it's one of the main themes of my whole process here, is this idea of neuroplasticity, right? So when you think differently, when you do some of these thought exercises that we've been doing, working in the journal and thinking about things and contemplating things, your brain changes. And when your brain changes, your thinking changes. And one of the things that happens is that you start getting new kinds of ideas. And where do they come from? Well, they come from your subconscious mind, basically. I mean, that's one way of thinking about it, right? So to my way of thinking, and I find this so exciting, I can hardly keep into my seat. Because when I heard you talking about having this dream and having a new, you know, moving up and down the chain, as you put it, you know, and looking at your possible futures, and you were in this kind of a, you said, a quasi-dream state, right? Well, to me, that is evidence of neuroplasticity. The work you've been doing with the journal and playing around with these different concepts and learning to look at them different ways, now your subconscious mind is starting to communicate with you. It's starting to talk to you, saying, hey, look at this. You know, you could do this, you could do that, you could go here, you could go there. And the other thing you said, which I think was really profound, is when you look at the future, and you think about the goals and things that you have. It's kind of like pieces of a puzzle. You said you can move them around, right? You know,
right.
You move to a different city, buy a different, you know, buy a cabin in the mountains, you know, buy a place on Hawaii, right? I mean, all these are possibilities that you could incorporate into your life. So I thought that that story that you told about having that dream, even though we didn't talk about it very long, I thought it was just profound, because to me, what I heard you talking about was my brain's changing. I'm getting new kinds of insights. I'm getting new kinds of ideas. I'm starting to understand this mental time travel idea in a new way, right?
I totally agree. It's interesting to hear you have picked up on that and to reinforce it, because I've been, and I have to apologize, I was talking like crazy the last couple of sessions, Jessica. You barely got a word in. You're such a great listener and coach, too. I've kind of followed you a little bit in your coaching. You're both really good coaches. But I was kind of putting some of this together, and I was certainly re-listening. It's funny you said five times. I think I've re-listened three times now to the last session or two. I've been taking notes of things, but seeing some patterns, but you picked up on the topic. I was getting the science of neuroplasticity and the dual mind, and I think it was it Sperry? That I was reading some stuff about Sperry that you talked about and his science, and seeing what that's doing by... When you can remap your mind, like, I think whenever we try to do something new, it's difficult. In the beginning, it's hard to change, but it becomes increasingly easier to change the pattern as your neurons connect differently.
Right.
And so now all of a sudden, what was difficult before to think certainly now becomes easier as we're talking about this. They start traveling up and down. But, you know, it's funny when you talk about the two bridges. You don't have to travel both bridges to get advice from both future use. You can actually think of it and say, well, if I go this way, he's going to say on the right will be a bridge, and on the left will be the water, and the less even water down below, and the city will look like this when we get there. But I don't have to really go there. That one has poor traffic patterns, right? So I'm going to mentally go the other way and say there'll be a bridge on your left and do the same. But you could be sitting in your house and having taken neither trip, but you could imagine it and get some advice. Well, don't take the other one unless the radiator's been repaired because you're having trouble with your car, right? Mm-hmm. So you say, well, hey, I think I'll go fix my car today because I forgot about that, okay? And say it fell off my to-do list, but now it's back on there. So neither trip did you take, but one changed what some of the things you're doing today, which is kind of like the map with Hawaii and everything else too, right? So that's a simple example. I couldn't help but laugh. I think it was from your book when you said the guy that kept, you know, making lunch the wrong way. And then he was driving on. He said, "Yeah, you drive it on the other freeway." And you know, these two comical characters were. It's so funny that the one continued to live the crappy life, which is like us continuing to be frustrated emotionally because a lot of the last talk was emotion. I'm as stupid as the guy that's taking the wrong freeway to work or eating the wrong sandwich. I'm picking that.
Yeah.
Well, you're talking. You're both talking about beliefs. And I think you're getting it. The neuroplasticity is with the belief is that I will always be positive and I reject these routes to go negative emotion by figuring different ways to do things. It's very powerful because you constantly appear to other people in such a great mood. Mm-hmm. You know, it's cumulative.
Yeah.
As I've been dealing with customers, even since this last week, I've been changing my approach to people and what I'm doing, and the result is so positive because they don't normally see that. You know, they see variability or they see negativity and those things from many other people, but when they appear and you're able to consistently be positive and, you know, routing a different way, okay, they don't want to do that, we'll get it a different way. We'll get them from the customer. We'll get this here. We'll work around it. And you also said that there is no right or wrong. When you stop putting the meaning of right or wrong, that guy's being wrong when he's asking for this, or this guy's wrong when he's doing that. Well, remove that. It's so much faster.
Mm-hmm.
You remove all that emotionality up and down, and you say, what does he need? You need this piece of paper. Here it is. Let's get what you need. Here, boom, now you're through it. You're like, wow, we just navigated that. That would have taken 2 hours before because you're going to argue about if you should get it, We have to get it, why we're getting it, what we mean by it. Boom, here's the piece of paper, we're done. 3 minutes.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Right.
So, yeah, so this idea of neuroplasticity, changing your thinking, changing your brain, getting new insights, to me, that's what's happening with you right now, you know.
Anyways, getting to the third eye, that's interesting that you brought that up, because it was this ennui other kind of realm place you've been. And I've had some people pass away recently and seen some experiences while they were passing, for example, the spiritual realm a bit. That it kind of touches on that, and this looking forward to who you want to be kind of all starts to meld a bit, where it's at an emotional, spiritual level, kind of this other dimension that you're talking about.
Yeah.
Other dimension. That there's, this is not just an analytical pursuit, but it's also a spiritual, as you start remapping, it kind of is like, well, how does it feel to take this bridge or that bridge?
Yeah. Like, you don't have... Exactly. Well, when I, you know, it's interesting that you say that when you started exploring ESP, you know, your religious beliefs kind of got in the way, right? They blocked you somehow. I had exactly the same experience because, you know, I was raised as a Catholic in the church, right? And there's good and evil, the devil and, you know, whatever, right? So when I first got into looking at ESP... it was scary. I was terrified that I was going to lose my soul.
Right.
Well, even to hear me say that now, it kind of sounds strange. But man, when I was like 15 years old and I was first starting to explore this idea of, you know, opening your third eye, that's what I was bumping up against, and it terrified me, the idea that, you know, I was going to be surrendering to the devil.
Right.
That's what I thought, you know. Well, then when I did that, when I actually took some courses and learned how to, you know, open my third eye, I realized, hey, this is the most natural thing in the world. It's just using your imagination, right? But people don't think about that. They don't see it that way because they have a different model, right? They have a different metaphor of the way things work. It's like when I was in Thailand and I mentioned to you that I spent some time in this monastery, right? And I was talking to one of the monks one day and I said, you know, what do you think about sin? Because sin was a big thing for me at the time, you know? You saw my first, you saw my one-man play, right?
Right.
So I talked about, you know, about sin. And the idea was, sin, God's going to punish you because sin is against one of his laws, right? And so this Lama that I was talking to said, oh, in Buddhism, there's no sin. And I went, what? No sin, right? Because that was a big thing for my whole life, you know. Don't sin, follow the rules, follow the law, do what you're supposed to do, think these thoughts, believe this. You know, I was so indoctrinated with that. But then when I realized later, you know, studying Buddhism, they have this thing called karma. Well, karma comes from the Sanskrit word for to do, right? Kur is the verb to do in Sanskrit. So karma means you do something and you get results. And I got this... black fingernail because I jammed my finger in the door, right? So that's karma. And so thinking about what we talked about a couple of weeks ago, thinking is a behavior. Well, now that thought, which when I first thought of it years ago, thinking is a kind of a behavior, which is something I picked up from Buddhism. It's like, well, of course, you know, you think this thought, like you say, you know, you expect to go over the bridge downtown. You know, you think that the other bridge, the traffic is blocked. So you take the other bridge and you find out, I made a mistake. It's this bridge that's blocked. I heard something on the radio. Now I'm stuck in the traffic. I was trying to avoid the traffic jam, but now I'm stuck in it. Well, that's karma, right? It's like you made the choice to do this rather than that. And so this whole thing now, it's kind of coming full circle here, where thinking is a behavior. You know, you have inner senses, you have outer senses. The way you think determines, or at least influences, what happens in your life. It influences your feelings, your emotions, the kind of thoughts you have, the kind of opportunities you create for yourself, right? And it's the most natural thing in the world. It's just closing your eyes and just using your imagination. But these beliefs that we, you know, that we're all created, as Bill Maher says, you know, all these religious beliefs were created by people that didn't know what a germ was, didn't know what a disease was. You know, a storm would come, they wouldn't know what caused the storm, right? Or lightning and those kind of things. They didn't know what that stuff was. So they created all these gods that were controlling everything on Earth, right?
Right.
Well, now it's like, hey, we don't believe that stuff anymore. At least some of us don't believe it. But so that's the big shift, I think, that's happening. You know, when you remember the show Hair, right?
Mm-hmm.
That scandalous, yep. Scandalous play where people were naked on stage, you know? And one of the songs there, I think it's from Hair, was, you know, this is the dawning of the age of Aquarius, right?
Right.
And the idea was that, you know, Pisces was the last, you know, the last age, right? Now we're moving into Aquarius. And the idea is that consciousness is awakening up again. You know, we're more conscious now, right? So all this new age hippie stuff that I was immersed in, you know, in the 60s and 70s. Now it all seems to be, you know, it's on point, right? We're all, well, not all of us, but certainly many of us are learning how to use our mind and our consciousness and visualizing and believing in future self. You know, all these kind of ideas now, they're making sense, right?
Well, yeah, one of the things that's been appearing to me and that's been changing who I am very quickly, I saw Jessica making a lot of changes as she started working with you, was I realized that we are choosing the life that we are picking. We don't, you know, whether consciously or unconsciously, I came up from a very similar Catholic upbringing, and we've been kind of Christian, Lutheran, non-practicing, something in that range. With many friends from Hinduism to Buddhism, and being, you know, exploring these religions quite deeply too, and seeing they're all working and the many benefits of good things that I've taken from those. So you end up with this kind of hybrid religious belief. But you are choosing every aspect of your life, consciously or unconsciously. Now, once you realize it's unconsciously, and you have choices that are now available to you to say, I want to tweak this a little more and change that. You're gathering unto you your tribe.
Mm.
That makes sense. You guys, yep, are part of my tribe. You're similar-minded people with a similar consciousness. But and that's one part. But then all of a sudden you start to say, I can entirely change my life. If I make these other future choices, now other tribe mates will approach me that have similar projects, goals, things in mind, and all of a sudden you can immediately change. Because of neuroplasticity, like you said, Jessica was saying, within a year they are a different person.
Right. Before you, well, you started working with your workbook in February, right?
Right.
And here it is now June, end of June. So for you, it's been like 4 months or something.
Right.
And now I'm starting to see these shifts in your thinking, right? Like having this dream. To me, that was really a profound experience to have that dream, because it's similar to the dream I had when I was a kid, right? I mean, I can still remember what I saw in that dream, and it wasn't actually a seeing. It was more like a sensing, right?
Once I mentioned to you, I'm like, what is this? It was kind of like, am I right in seeing what I think I'm seeing here in this shift? That, you know, I mentioned, I paralleled, I think, to speaking another language.
Mm-hmm.
I said, I'm seeing a shift in my, I guess it was, I wasn't thinking of it that way, but neuroplasticity, and then maybe approaching the third eye, you know, the spiritual realm where I'm starting to think about things differently. It's funny, when I was reading some of the information, you know, I used to dream a lot as a young kid. When I was 5 and 6, I used to draw a lot and dream, or like I would get birthday cards from my sister, said, "You have such a great imagination."
Mm-hmm.
And at first I wasn't sure if that was an insult or if that was a, you know, compliment, because it's like, well, no one.
It was an insult.
Yeah, you know, it was, and I think it was, she was seeing the good. I think it was good-hearted, what she meant. But I wasn't like, you know, no one wants to be a silly bot, right?
I don't think of myself,
right? But from the positive side, the dreamer is the guy that's like Branson, that all of a sudden it develops a FedEx model or something like that. It can be very powerful when it's practical.
Oh, yeah.
So I had better results even at work recently in the last, the things like, you know, tangible differences. I mean, we're on a trip, you know, my wife had arranged much of this, but which interestingly, when I met my wife when I was 15, I said, "I'm going to marry that girl."
Mm.
I saw her, like, across the, we were at a festival, and she was on a Ferris wheel with a buddy of mine, and she was laughing. And I said, "I want to be around that girl, so I'm going to marry her."
Right.
And so I consequently did. But, you know, it's funny how this is all becoming very real, you know, realistic, I guess, to change what I'm choosing for my life. And that's why it's the first time I saw any sense of control over that. Before, in all the ways I was doing it was goal planning.
Yes.
15% yeah. More. What does 15% more production every year look like? Pretty blasé, frankly. You know, I mean, that's not that interesting to me. But maybe to live in a different place or with different people, doing different projects. I mean, money is only one aspect to that. It's probably certainly not the most important. You know, other things are much more important than that. Like we mentioned, time with family and stuff. I put out a call about setting up a reunion,
right?
By the way, but I mean,
oh, you did, good. Those,
you know, and I had that in motion. You know, but traveling, doing a little more travel. I bought a travel package that was incredibly cheap for 27 nights of travel. It was $500.
Wow.
You know, through, I don't even give you the name of it, but sponsor ERG. So we'll see. It's part of Hyatt.
Hmm.
But I, you know, so some of these things are, and it's, it doesn't take a lot of money to make that choice to grab that opportunity to change what you're doing. It's just changing what you're doing.
Yeah, exactly. Changing what you're thinking and changing what you're doing. But like you said, it's, you know, it's a lot easier to talk about than it is to actually do it, right? And so doing these exercises, you know, writing in the workbook and contemplation and visualizing and kind of figuring something out. How do we, you know, what does this mean? You know, what does that mean, right? It takes work. It takes effort. And like Earl Nightingale says, you know, thinking is the greatest effort there is. That's why so few people do it. Now we can understand, right? Because like for me, I mean, I can only talk from my own experience, but for me, you know, some of these concepts that I put in my book, I spent weeks and months thinking about those and trying to figure out what in the heck is going on here. What does this mean? You know, what is happening with me? And you know, how do I explain it? And what does it mean to me, right? So, yeah, it was effort. You know, it was a lot of hard work.
Well, can I just... Yeah, I just want to say something about kind of what you were talking about a couple minutes ago. Is what came to mind was even not making a decision is a decision. And I feel like what's happening with you right now is you're becoming more conscious of the fact that some of those undecisions that you've been making have created your reality. And now you're saying, no, I want to be in control and I want to consciously make my decisions. That's kind of what I'm seeing as a big shift for you right now. Would you sort of agree with that?
Totally. And that's where I was, what I was going to say is the journal is kind of interesting. Writing is slower than talking. Talking is slower than thinking. But when you write in the journal, you have to synthesize the best thoughts of your thoughts. Right. That makes sense. We cover a lot of territory thinking about a lot of concepts here. But when I go back and say, well, what do you want to really write about today? Out of all of these things, you know, don't write about stuff you don't want to do. Don't write about stuff that you're doing that you never wanted to do. Write about stuff that you really want to do out of all of these kind of paths that you can take. Say, what's really appealing? You're like picking the best personality trait.
Yeah. Well, I have a feeling that...
you know, the fact that you're saying the writing is...
Yeah, exactly. I come from the same place as you just described, you know, like when I first learned about the goal setting, right? First of all, it was just a routine. It was just a thing that I was doing because I heard about it from Paul Meyer, other people too, but he was the one that was, you know, sort of my main teacher as far as goal setting is concerned. With this workbook. And so when I first started to do it, it was just, you know, what do I want? And, you know, writing down these silly ideas, which I thought, you know, they're impossible. I can never do these things. But, you know, just going through this exercise, right? And then after a while, I realized, well, hey, actually, you know, there's different levels of these goals and desires. And some of them I can do right now. Like I mentioned, shining my shoes. You know, when I was at my low ebb at one time, I figured, well, that's something I can do right now. I can shine my shoes. And strangely enough, it made a difference, right? But then later I realized, as you're pointing out, I can make a decision like, I think I'd like to live in Europe for a couple of years and move to Europe. You know, which I did, right? Lived in Germany for 2 years. And my life was totally different there, right? Just from that little decision. Okay, you know, I'm going to move to Germany, buy an airplane ticket, go there. You know, here I am now, totally different environment, right? So the idea of these goals kind of shifted from just fantasies, you know, just an exercise in kind of doodling on paper, right? To all of a sudden moving into, hey, I can actually create my life this way, you know? And so now I think with Ben Hardy's work, with the Future Self Now, I think once we get into this book, we're going to find out that some of the exercises and things that he has in there are really going to make a profound difference. It's going to accelerate the whole process, right? When you start to sort of operate, not from here, looking at there being the future, but you're in the future looking back at now, right? Like you said, you know, crossing the bridge, right? Like if I hear on the news, oh, there's an accident on Bridge A, so my mind says, okay, well, I want to go downtown. I'm not going to take that bridge because I'll get stuck in the traffic, right? So without even going there, I can make a decision to go the other way. Right. So I can get information from the possible future, which, you know, sees me stuck in the traffic jam, right? Right. So your mind is always working in the past and the future. And the stuff that you learn, the beliefs, we've talked about this already, you know, certainly the religious beliefs and some of the ideas that I was sort of programmed, you know, that were programmed into me when I was, you know, 4 years, 5 years, 6 years old. Man, I had to struggle to break free of those as I got older.
Well, you know, what's interesting, one of the things I was saying was that if you go forward to the future you that is at the end of the bridge, you may come back and say, by the way, don't forget to bring jumper cables, right? Or something, because your battery's a little low. If you park over there and it's a colder day, you know, maybe you've got to do that.
Exactly.
In a more other examples, you say, well, if you're going to climb a mountain in 3 years, you might want to start getting in shape. Which reminded me of Jessica's statement in 2005. She was a single mom struggling, right? Or she made the choice to no longer try to goal set and do the 10 things on her, the New Year's resolutions that were never happening. But instead, she now starts to say, I think I'll be a different me.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, she was able to shift by dropping the, the analogy is, you might not want to bring, I'm a single mom that's struggling across the bridge with you. Because it's going to be a long trip, you know. Instead, drop that baggage and become a powerful coach that's trained, that's learning, that's helping other people. I mean, that's what I'm seeing, like, in this transformation. Like, there's a lot of thinking before you decide to be a coach that she did. She took training classes, and she met you, and she looked for her tribe a little bit, you know, like-minded people that are interested in real change.
Yeah.
Transformation for life in a big way. I mean,
exactly. Well, this is why, for me, it's such a thrill, you know, to talk to you guys, because we all met because of my book.
Yeah.
So those ideas that I wrote in the book, they're the sort of commonality that it's like, it's kind of like, you know, you bump into somebody who likes the same kind of, you know, music that you do, right? You can talk about all these stars, you know, the songs that you like and stuff like that. So we have this kinship, right? Because we have these similar kind of ideas. So that's really gratifying to me, you know, when you say, meeting your tribe, right?
Yeah. Well, I think of you like a little bit, I'm not trying to blow smoke at you. I think that, you know, in olden times, in Crete, you'd go to the sage, I don't know if I'm giving the right name for it, but the oracle.
Right.
You'd go to oracle for advice.
Mm-hmm.
And why would you travel that far and go to the oracle? The oracle is a person that was a philosopher that spent a lot of time on philosophy. There was a lot of philosophers in Greece.
Mm-hmm.
It was pretty common to have philosophers in the town center, I think, back in Greece. But you went to them for advice, and it's to make these major shifts in the way you think, which changes the way you live. I mean, and not only, maybe it doesn't change much of what you do, certainly it changes the way you feel about what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of these people were not interested in money. They were interested in poetry. They were interested in art.
Yeah.
Renaissance.
Yeah, that's right. Well, I think, you know, I mean, if reincarnation is true, I've been doing this for a long time. You know, lifetimes,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. I believe that's possible.
I mean, I have no evidence. I have no evidence for that, but then who cares, you know?
There's a lot of evidence for that. I mean, as I was saying, I think now we're seeing, talking about the veil kind of lifting. I think that through some of the things like YouTube and different means of direct communication between people that are away from the mainstream media, that people, and in this platform that we're doing this right now, people are able to get together and say there's significant evidence that there's things like reincarnation, there's near-death experiences, and everybody's saying, tell the same story and make a little money. Unskeptical way to look at it. But if you put that, your disbelief about that for a minute, look at the evidence that instead there's many people that are reporting. I mean, like I said, I saw someone pass that was speaking to their mother on their deathbed.
Right.
The person standing in the room, you can say it's either chemical neurology, or else it's the truth, right?
Yeah, exactly.
The spiritual realm. You know, a lot of them report that there are experiences with near death, but also past life regression, things like that. There's enough people that have independently had past life regression to start speaking Chinese.
Yeah, well, the problem in all of that is that, you know, we were programmed to believe, shall I say, the priesthood, right?
Right.
You know, like we were programmed, or I was programmed when I was a kid, you know, listen to what the priest says, listen to what the Bible says, listen to what, you know, your teachers say, and those kind of things. And, you know, the idea that maybe they were full of hot air, didn't know what they were talking about, you know, that didn't occur to me until later, right? As I mentioned in that one-man play, you know, when I was 8 years old, went to talk to the priest and realized, wait a second, this guy doesn't know anything, you know.
Right.
So, but now the priesthood is the scientists, right? Scientists, you know, like Wallace Wattles said in one of his books in 1900, thinking in a certain way will change your brain. People thought, this guy is so out to lunch, it's ridiculous, right? 100 years later, 1995 now, people go, oh, hey, guess what? He was right, you know. But he was talking from his own experience because he was experiencing this, right? And that's where I came from, because I was taking these courses in, visualizing and metaphysics and law of attraction and, you know, using your inner senses, right? And when I read in it wasn't exactly in his book that I read it the first time, but a similar book. And it said, you know, doing these thought exercises changes your brain. And I realized, hey, that's what's happening with me. You know, my brain's changing because my world was changing. I looked out into the world. I saw different things, you know. I didn't see problems anymore. I saw opportunities, right? So this idea that neuroplasticity, you know, these thinking exercises change your brain, change your life. It was real for me, right? And so when I heard about what was happening with the functional MRI in the 90s, it blew my mind, because I had no idea until I read about it that they had made this discovery, you know. And most people have not heard about it, even today. It's like 20 years later.
Well, it's interesting to say, you know, I think it's a little bit like COVID. It reminds me of COVID. When we first had COVID, we approached it very tentatively because we didn't know what it was. And it's kind of like that when you break out of these oligarchy kind of situations, you know, and you start saying, well, I'm going to read a little bit about Buddhism, or, you know, for me and my development, or I'm going to read a little about ESP, or I'm going to read a little bit about this. And so you kind of look around and you're like, okay, nothing's happened yet. I mean, you know, I think it's smart, you know, careful as you approach those things.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I mean, for me, you know, I was terrified, you know, when I decided to sort of, you know, give myself over to the dark side, kind of, you know,
right.
to use the, you know, the vernacular, right? Because that's what I thought. I thought it was the dark side, right? And I was going to lose my soul or something. Well, in some way, like when I went to talk to the priest that I mentioned in my play, I said, I think I'm losing my faith. Well, I was right. I was. Because what's faith? You know, faith is basically believing something you have no evidence for. You just believe it, right? Well, there's good faith and there's bad faith in that sense, right?
Right.
One of the things I always say to a client when I'm working with them and I'm suggesting something that might be a little bit outside of their normal thinking process is I always say, you don't have to buy it. Just try it on.
Yeah. Exactly.
Because it somehow takes the pressure off. It's like I can explore this without having to take it on, right? And that seems to allow people to explore it with less reservation, I find.
Exactly, yeah. Try it on. If it doesn't fit, you can take it back.
Yeah.
I look at a lot of this as like your software, right? Because I deal with people of different faiths, and I don't judge anybody. We all have to deal with different people as we run into them. In business or recruiting, when I did recruiting for many years, I was helping people switch jobs, and you're hearing about all their intimate details of their life. But I looked at it like, what's your software? If it works for you, keep running it.
Mm-hmm.
If it doesn't work for you, then you have to, maybe it's like taking the blue pill from the Matrix or something. You know, when do you want it, or the green pill, whatever it is, the red or blue pill, whatever it is. But, you know, the idea is that, you know, if you want to live in that world the way it's working, that's fine. But if you want to look at behind the veil a little bit, see if that works for you, resonates true, you know, then you can approach some of these concepts and see if these work better for you. So I'm excited about,
right,
you know, getting a little deeper into these topics. This is pretty deep as we're talking, but it's working for me. It's, you know, it's, I don't know, but I was like, am I having a midlife crisis or is this a spiritual epiphany? I can't tell which one it is, but.
I call it a midlife awakening. How's that
right.
feel?
That feels better, Jessica. I like that.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, epiphany, right? Yeah, they say in the East, they talk about a flash of lightning on a dark night. It's like suddenly, boom, you know, you understand something or you see something. And You know, well, that's great. That's great. So, so I guess the affirmation for this week is get a copy of that book.
Got it.
Be your future self now. Cause that's what I'm looking forward to get. Good. Yeah, I'm looking forward to getting into it. And, you know, we'll have a lot to talk about, I think, in upcoming
session. Before we go, it might open up a huge rabbit hole. I don't know. But I'm curious, did we ever find out, like, what insight you got from your dream, Greg?
Well, the biggest thing there was that it was a cord. It was like an astral cord, but it was almost like I was riding up and down between future and past and realizing that my past I could change by my perceptions, which would change my now, which is the pivotal point. But the future point was that I could travel up to those two and talk to other future me's and get advice.
Yeah.
And I didn't have to do all the work of doing every one of those paths, but that I actually could gather a little bit of advice from each of them. Like, bring your jumper cables and do this and do that. I mean, I can look and say, you know, if you want to be healthy, Mr. Healthy Icon, okay, says you better stop eating sugar and carbs, right? Because you're going to have a hard time bucking the odds if you don't do that. So for me, that became an immediate thing. I said, well, I've had trouble doing that. But then I think, well, wait a minute, but I didn't really know about neuroplasticity. So if I could just do the one-minute goal, for example, you know, maybe I could get this thing to where it starts to become easier to get rid of sugar and carbs.
Yeah, like maybe. Jessica says, try it on for a minute.
Yeah. So, you know, so I was doing some of those things. So I mean, like, okay, so I bought your book, by the way, the smoking book. I bought a hard copy of it, so I have it. And I was using it as a prototype for other solutions, and we talked a little bit about that. But it's like, it's a method. It's kind of a methodology. You know, there's other ways to do some things, but there were some tools that you had in there, and they seemed to work. So, like, well, why not try that on sugar and carbs?
Exactly. Yeah, exactly right.
You know, and so, well, then I might have some results there. So that's one time you look with the cord. The next one is, well, what do you want to do with alcohol? What do you want to do with work? Or what do you want to do with relationship? Or what do you want to do with money? You know, so you go meet the money guru in the future. And you spend a little time with him. Spend a half hour with the money guru in your mind in the future. And see what he says. He says, you're doing the right things. Don't worry about it. Or he says, well.
Yeah. Have you read Think and Grow Rich?
I did it many years ago. I actually put it down to buy it again and reread it because I was a younger man. And I think it seemed very lofty. I was like, I don't know how to go from here to being an oil baron.
Right.
You know?
Right. You could be a baron of beef, maybe. Well, one of the things he talks about in there, and you'll remember it when I remind you, he used to have this visualization exercise where he would be sitting at a table with all his advisors. You remember?
I didn't remember that, no.
And the advisors were people like, you know, George Washington, Abraham Lincoln, Plato, Socrates, Galileo, you know, captains of industry, right? And he would talk to those people. And he even said at one point, as I remember, he got a little scared because those people started to become so real to him that he thought, maybe I'm losing my mind, you know. And another bit of insight I had, which I think is a great idea, is using your past as a resource, right? Now, I've talked about this before, using your past as a resource. This is kind of the origin of the past successes list, right? So I remember thinking, well, what have I done in the past that was successful? Now, I was talking about doing seminars on personal growth, right? Mind power, visualization, that kind of thing. And so I was working in the binder, you know, in the workbook, and I thought, okay, what are some of my past things that I've done that might help me now, right? That I can use now. And one of them was I was a gardener. And I thought, well, what did I learn when I was gardening? Well, one of the things I learned was how to prune trees. You know, there's a way of pruning trees, right? And so I thought, okay, well, how can I use that? Like, that's a piece of knowledge that I have that if I'm not pruning a tree, when do I use it, right? But when I was writing the book, I thought, hey, that's a perfect analogy for making a decision, right? If you have two choices, it's like, you know, do I go over bridge A or bridge B? Well, I'm going to go over bridge A. Okay, prune the possibility of bridge B, just gone now, right? Which, coincidentally, is the origin of the word decide. Because the word decide comes from two Latin words, de, which means from, and cede, which means to cut, right? So suicide, sui means self. So suicide, same word, right? Suicide means to cut yourself, kill yourself, you know? Homicide means to kill a person or to, you know, stab a person, right? So the idea of decide means to cut away. Well, that fit in perfectly with my personal growth seminars that I was doing. I talked about, you know, pruning your beliefs, pruning your decisions and things like that, right? Pruning your self-image, you know. I don't do that anymore. I don't smoke anymore. I don't drink anymore. You know, I don't do that anymore. Just prune it away. So that's where the idea came from for me personally, was the idea that I was looking at my past thinking, you know, what have I learned in the past that I can use right now? And one of the ideas was pruning trees. When you make a decision, in some way, kind of a weight is taken off you, right? Because before you make the decision, this is why it's so important to set goals. Because before you make the decision, it's like, should I go over A? Should I do B? Should I do A? Should I do B? Well, in a way, your mind is kind of working on both, right? Your mind is sort of saying, well, if you do A, then all this stuff can happen, you know, and if you do B, all this stuff can happen. So you're sort of wasting a certain amount of energy on two things. But if you say, okay, I'm not going to do B, I'm going to do A, then all of that energy goes down that branch. And again, I learned that from pruning trees, right? Because if you have a tree, it's got two branches, right? Well, you cut the branch off, the roots haven't changed, all the roots are still there. So all of the work that the roots are doing going up the trunk of that tree, before the energy was split in half, right? 50% to one side, 50% to the other side. But if you prune one away, then 100% of the energy goes to that branch. So it's like you got more energy available to reach the goal that you have now decided that you're going to reach, right? So all of those concepts, they came from me looking at my past and going, you know, I used to like gardening and pruning. What? How can I use that now, right?
Right.
I still do pruning. I was pruning one of my trees this week. What's that?
In one of your books you wrote about landscaping, which or something, the original book, you brought it up. Or something.
Oh, yeah, The Master Gardener, right. Yeah, being the gardener and cultivating your garden.
I thought it was wonderful. And we've got a big hill. We're going to do some gardening. I didn't call you. Be like, hey, give me some advice. But because I was going to write it down and find it. I was like, wow, that was just such a good dissertation on how to. But like you said, you could turn that to any project. I was thinking about
absolutely,
that.
Yeah. Well, I learned that from a friend of mine, John Kehoe, who was teaching Mind Power at the same time I was, and we crossed paths back and forth across the country, right? And so I went to his seminar, he went to my seminar, and, you know, we've kept in touch now. We're still friends, 40 years later. And that was one of the things that he said, you know, treat your life as a garden, right? You're the gardener. You can cultivate whatever you want. You can prune away whatever you want, and you can get rid of whatever you want, you know. So I use that in my book.
I was using it also in my work recently. I started using the past. This week I was looking at the past successes, as you talked about, and I started looking. I'm a CPA, so I passed the CPA exam.
Hmm.
For example, so passing that was a very difficult, it's like passing the bar. And so you had to break it down into little parts, components, you had to see what you knew, what you didn't know, which, if one of those things you didn't know, you had to do more of. And I would break it down into little time components, stuff like that, but it's
right. Like anything. Yeah, well, being a CPA, you know, what are you doing there? But you're categorizing things, right?
Right.
So you make, you know, these columns and you put, you know, different expenses and things in them. Well, you can do that with things like past successes or beliefs or emotions, you know. Like if I want to feel, like you were talking last week about, you know, wanting to feel a certain way, right? Well, you could have a column in your workbook. You know, you put five past events that generate that feeling, that emotion, right? It's kind of like, oh, here's some expenses here. We got another category of expenses. These are automobile expenses. These are housing expenses. These are personal expenses, you know, entertainment expenses, right? So you could do the same thing there. You could say, you know, what memories do I have that generate the feeling of confidence? Which is my new book, by the way. what past experiences do I have that make me feel powerful or make me feel lucky, right? So you could teach that that concept right from your learning that you figured out being a CPA.
Thank you. I didn't mean to take
it
a tangent, but I had to mention.
No, it's not a tangent at all. It all fits, right?
It's wonderful. I mean, I appreciate the learning here. I know we're sometimes we go a little long, but I was like, wow, I have a lot of advice that's about your kind of self-improvement because I wasn't seeing a result. It was like Chester in 2015. I said, I'm not seeing change. I'm not seeing any change from
right. Well, one of the things I was talking about lately, I've sent out a couple of emails this week. You might have seen one. Start a book club, you know. Start a Mind, Time, and Power book club. Get a few of your friends who you think might be interested in this, you know, tell them to buy a book. And then just have a weekly discussion like we're doing, right? Man, you'll learn more about the power of your mind talking to your friends. Because you'll be doing the same thing I'm doing with you, you know, is like, you guys are picking my brains. Well, I'm picking your brains, too. And so when you ask me, a question, like the thing about pruning is a good example, right? You ask me about that, it reinforces the whole concept to me, right? So if you were, to talk to people about using the past successes list and having a column, you know, five memories that generate confidence, five memories that generate self-esteem, you know, five items in this column that generate my ability to make a decision, right?
Right.
Then you can go back to those things. It's like, you know, I have specific memories. I mean, I've talked about a few of them already, but you know, for example, the yo-yo contest, right? Well, the yo-yo contest doesn't mean anything to you, but it's very meaningful for me because it's got all of those emotions that I can tap into, right? Feeling like a winner, feeling like I'm smart, I have the ability to practice something and to get good at it and to win over other people, you know, to be a champion, you know, all of those emotions. And I can just think about them, like right now I'm thinking about it because I'm talking about it. And so when you have specific events like that you can tap into that make you feel this way, then it stops being a theory and it starts being a practice, right? Okay. Oops.
Jessica said you'd say brilliant things once in a while in this interaction with us. You say some really brilliant things, and you do. I think one of you said was that in the moments of your decision, your destiny is formed, which you credited to Anthony Robbins.
Right.
That kind of similar, but I mean, she's right. You say some brilliant things this interaction, and I did hear what you said about forming a group. I've kind of started towards that a little bit.
Yeah, good.
So
that's the best way to. That's the best way to learn the material, right?
Yeah.
One of my favorite sayings, and it might mean something more to you now, is your power is only one thought away.
Yeah. Well, that's why I buy books. I buy books, I buy literature, audio tapes, podcasts. I mean, it's just change your mind, change your life.
The beautiful thing about doing a book club, or like what we get to do here, is that we get to, everyone has a different take on it, right? And so you can read something.
That's right.
And you interpret it through your own experiences and whatever, and then you hear Greg say it, and it's like, oh, I never thought of it that way.
Exactly.
And then I have a take on it, and it's like, whoa, and it just, that one simple thing that you read or heard now has like expanded, because now you've got everybody else's take on it. That's the beautiful, that's why I love this so much.
Oh, exactly. And you know what's funny, lots of times I've had this experience, you know. As a matter of fact, I think I've had this experience more than once with you guys, where somebody will say to me, you know, I read this thing in your book and it really changed my life. It changed something for me, right? And I'll go, oh, what was that? And they'll say, you said this. And I'll go, really? Did I say that? You know. Sometimes I forget, or I'll say, you know, like I'll say it to myself, right? I won't say it out loud, but I'll say it to myself. Oh, well, I didn't mean that. You know, the words didn't mean what that person thought they meant, at least to me, right? But if they meant that to them, great, right? You know, like Bob Dylan said, I just write the songs. I don't explain them.
Very good.
Yeah.
Well,
thanks. Okay, all thanks, right. You guys.
Thank you. Talk to you soon.
Awesome.
Talk to you later.
Thanks,
okay.
Guys.
Yeah, bye-bye. For more information about this online community, to get your own copy of the book upon which this entire training series is based, either the ebook, the paperback, or the audiobook, go to mindtimeandpower.com, where you can also get a free copy of this Design Your Life workbook.